Well, welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to the National World War I Museum and Memorial. My name is James Taub, and I'm the public program specialist here. And whether you're joining us in person, online, live, or later on, we thank you very much for being with us tonight in a continuation of our partnership with the Department of Military History at the United States Army Command and General Staff College. Now, I'd like to introduce tonight's speaker. Dr. John Kuehn is a professor of military history at the United States Army Command and General Staff College. He retired from the United States Navy in 2004 at the rank of commander after 23 years serving as a naval flight officer flying land and carrier-based aircraft. He was awarded the Moncado Prize from the Society of Military History in 2011, and he is, I have to say, a repeat presenter at the National World War I Museum and Memorial, both in this series as well as our symposia. Ladies and gentlemen, help me in welcoming back Dr. John Kuehn.
Thanks, James. I appreciate that. I was going to shake his hand, but he ran away. Thanks for coming out. Thanks, all you guys, for coming out tonight, those that are joining us online. This is one of my favorite topics, so this could actually end up being pretty long. I could probably go all night on this. So the way I got interested in this particular conference, which occurred 100 years ago, beginning on November 12th. So November 12th, 1921 was when the Washington Conference began. It was the Washington Conference on Arms Limitation. And essentially, the purpose of it was to kind of finish the unfinished business of the Great War, to kind of finish. There were some loose ends that needed tying up. And so the United States took the lead on this. It invited all the major powers to Washington, D.C., in the late fall, which is a beautiful time in Washington if the leaves are still on the trees, and to have this conference. Not far, in a place called Constitution Hall, which belonged to the Daughters of the American Revolution, not far from today's Vietnam War Memorial. So if you go to Washington, D.C., you go to the Vietnam War Memorial, the Washington Conference was just a stone's throw away from that memorial. What got me interested in the Washington Conference was I had studied Versailles and the limitations that Versailles had placed on the German Army and the German Navy. And it seemed to me the limitations actually helped the Germans innovate at the tactical and maybe even the operational level of war, both for their Navy and for their Army. Because in limiting what they could do, how much they could spend, it actually caused the Germans to think about things a little bit more and to study the problems they needed to solve a little bit more honestly. And so I thought, well, I wonder if Washington did the same thing for the other navies of the world, the Japanese Navy, the United States Navy, and the Royal Navy, to say nothing of the French Navy and the Italian Navy. So those are the big five that are at this. So that's just sort of a backdrop for why I got interested in this. This is actually the first day of the conference. That's a shot that they took at the end of the day. Right in the middle is President Warren G. Harding. So he sort of is the guy that invited everybody, although he was not officially on the American delegation to the conference. So here's the, let's see if we can make this work. Nope. Here's the agenda. Opening day, we're going to talk about the ratio system. Tonnages. We're going to be talking standard tons that equates to about 2,200 pounds. The battleship holiday. What do we mean by that? Do battleships take holidays? Okay. So we'll answer that question. The clauses. There's some different clauses that influence things. And there was a naval treaty that came out of this conference called the Five Power Treaty, sometimes called the Five Power Pact. Often called the Washington Naval Treaty. But there were a lot of other treaties that came out of the Washington Conference. There was a Four Power Pact, a Nine Power Pact, a Convention on the Use of Gas, a reaffirmation of cruiser rules for submarines. So there were a variety of agreements that occurred at Washington outside the bounds of the formal treaty. But mostly I'm going to talk about the Five Power Treaty, the Washington Naval Treaty, and then maybe some tentative conclusions. Well, here's the American team, and it, other than the first member, who's President Warren G. Harding, Ohio native from Crestline, Ohio. I always wonder if my grandmother knew him, because she was from Crestline, Ohio. But anyway, hopefully not, because Warren was kind of a bad boy. So he's the president. He's the one who invited everybody to the conference. Secretary of State Charles Evans Hughes, one of the great progressive go-to guys in the Roosevelt, Taft, and now the Harding administration. He'd run for president and came close to beating Wilson in 1916. Progressive Republican. He's the Secretary of State. He's the leader of the American delegation. It's a total effort here. We've got Senator Henry Cabot Lodge, the guy who killed the Treaty of Versailles, is on the team. Former Secretary of War Elihu Root. The Army folks in the audience will know Elihu Root. Elihu Root is the father of the modern Army that we have today, with the Army War College, the Army Staff, and the Chief of Staff of the Army. Elihu Root, Oscar Underwood from another senator, very influential. Ted Roosevelt is acting as Navy Secretary. He's on the team. And then the Navy technical representative is this guy, Captain William Pratt, selected to Rear Admiral. And he's the guy who's supporting the team directly on loan from the Navy. So a uniformed active duty officer. There's Harding, and there is the man, Charles Evans Hughes, later Chief Justice of the Supreme Court. So this is a very talented individual, and the Washington Conference is really his baby. Although Harding will take all the credit, this is the guy that really impresses everybody, and it's his vision that manages to kind of carry the day. And he is going to carry the day. He's going to carpe diem on 12 November, and nobody's expecting it. So let's get on with that story. The invitees, they're all familiar names. Arthur Balfour from Great Britain, Aristide Briand. Some of you know about the Kellogg-Briand pact. Yeah, that Aristide Briand. Baron Kato Tomasaburo from Japan. He was Togo's chief of staff at the Battle of Tsushima, a great Japanese hero, the Navy minister, future prime minister of Japan. His hometown, Hiroshima. Carl Schanzer of Italy, representatives from all the British dominions are there, and representatives from China, Portugal, the Netherlands. Missing, Germany. Because of Versailles. Her Navy's already limited. Her armed forces are already limited. Arms limitation with respect to Germany, done deal. So that's not a loose end that needs tying up. And then finally, the Soviet Union, which is a pariah state. Not there. Okay? There's Briand. That's actually a picture of him waving to the crowds at Washington. There's Kato Tomosaburo. An admiral, one of the most senior admirals in the Japanese Navy, but he's in civilian garb. He liked to emphasize his civilian role in all of this because he thought Japan might have a problem with militarism. And then Arthur Balfour. So this is how Hughes opens it up. And maybe I'll go back for a second. Well, I'll let you read that and while I talk about this. Why this conference? It's simple. Arms race. Arms race. The three major powers plus the two secondary major powers, Italy and France, are having a naval arms race after World War I. Well, World War I was supposed to solve that. There weren't supposed to be any more arms races. But instead, there's arms races. Racist legislation in the west coast of the United States, particularly in California, has resulted in the segregation of Japanese school children. So there's also a war scare between the United States and Japan. And so all of these powers are spending immense sums that they really need to spend on rebuilding the world, not just Europe, on naval platforms. So there's an arms race, and everybody's like, how did this happen? And so Harding says, we're going to kill this. He goes to Hughes, and he says, I want you to end this. We need to save money. And the speech, you can find it later, but basically they say, we've had enough of war, and we think the millions and millions of people in the world have had enough of war, and we're going to make that end right here at Washington. That was part of Harding's opening speech to the delegates. Then he turns it over to this guy, and everybody thinks that Charles Evans Hughes, the Secretary of State, is just going to kind of say, hey, everybody, welcome. You know, we're glad you're here. You know, now let's adjourn and go have drinks. That's what they think is going to happen. That's not what happens. He gives them a detailed plan for how to achieve arms limitation, particularly with respect to the navies on the first day, all right? And he sweetens the pot. He says, right now, 15 capital ships are being built. Over $330 million have been spent on these 15 capital ships that the United States is building to add to its already considerable fleet of battleships, right? A capital ship is a battleship or a battle cruiser, right? The main fleet, the big ships with the big guns that can go long ranges and stay on station. Still, the United States is willing, in the interest of an immediate limitation of naval armament, to scrap all these ships. As soon as he says that, a silence descends on the hall. And then the Japanese smile, and the French smile, and the Italian smile, and the British smile. Like, this guy is going to scrap the American fleet. All these modern warships, all these modern dreadnought battle cruisers and battleships that the United States is building with these great names like USS Washington, USS Lexington, USS Saratoga. The Americans are going to scrap them. And they can't believe their good luck. The United States proposes to scrap these capital ships now under construction, and then he lowers the boom and says, if the British scrap these, if the Japanese scrap these. Now, the way Hughes gets everybody on the defensive in the react mode here is he's offering to scrap almost 1 million tons of shipping. 1 million tons. So 1 million tons of shipping. How much shipping is that? That's 10 Nimitz-class carriers. That's how much shipping 1 million tons is. 10 Nimitz-class carriers, all right? So he says we're going to do it. Not only that, but we're going to take a capital ship holiday. We're not going to build any capital ships for another 15 years. How do you end an arms race? You just say, well, let's just not build anymore. We're going to freeze the status quo after we've scrapped down to what we need for self-defense, okay? Now the British delegate reputedly had his feet up on the table and was just, and then when he heard this, you could hear him kind of groan, and his feet came down off the table with a clunk, all right? And so this was a real moment for the British delegation. He's going to have a ratio of 5-5-3, five for the Americans, five for the Japanese, five for the British, and three for the Japanese. So what that means is, essentially, that will be their ratio. The cap is going to be at 530,000 tons, which is what the British are going to get. Now, it's not quite 553 when the treaty is signed, but that's what's going to be the final status quo steady state after everything is scrapped and whatever is agreed to go ahead and let build gets built, and whatever is go ahead and agreed to get scrapped gets scrapped, okay? In this, the British will still get the largest. So see how he's kind of playing the British. We're going to scrap more ships than you. We're going to let you actually have more tonnage than us, all right? And so he's already got the British in a situation where they can't say no, all right? Two, the same for the Japanese. The Japanese desperately need to save money. The Russo-Japanese War broke the bank. World War I also put Japan in a very poor economic situation. So she's on the ropes, and she can't be engaged in a naval arms race with the United States. So we've got a holiday, no battleships or battle cruisers for 15 years, a ratio system that's going to exist. It also exists for the French and the Italians, but they're actually ranked lower than the Japanese, which, by the way, ticks them off to no end. Wait a second, you're rating this Oriental power above two white European powers? That's not right. Okay, so they're kind of put on the defensive there. Their ratio is actually 1.75. So they're a little bit more than half of what the Japanese are allowed. Okay, and then the ratio also applies to aircraft carriers. 5-5-3 for aircraft carriers for the United States, Japan, and Great Britain. The benchmark will be the British tonnage and carriers that's actually in commission. So the British don't have to scrap any aircraft carriers, but They might want to so they can build new aircraft carriers. They won't, but that'll be the upper end. And then the Americans can be have as many tonnages as the British, and then the Japanese can have you know, the ratio of 3 to 5 of those aircraft carriers. Also, you can build warships, but they are going to be 10,000 tons or less and 8-inch gun max. All right, so they limit the auxiliaries. So this is the auxiliary clause. They do not impose ratios on the auxiliaries. There was some discussion at the conference to try to do that, but nobody could agree, so they could all agree, all right, you can't build anything bigger than 10,000 tons, and it can't have a gun bigger than 8-inch. There's only one exception to this, and this will be the aircraft carriers. The aircraft carriers can actually be as heavy as 27,000 tons, with some caveats that we'll talk about, all right? So no battleships, aircraft carriers, yes, but they're limited. Cruisers, yes, but they have to be 10,000 tons or less. The key compromises clauses are, the first one is the fortification clause. This is not a part of Hughes' proposal to the British and the Japanese. The British get with the Japanese and say, hey, this deal is, we have to accept this deal. We are going to have to. What do you need the Americans to do and compromise with in order to accept this? And the Japanese Navy Minister, Kato Tomosaburo, suppresses his naval advisors. He suppresses the fiery officers back home who say, we can't agree to this ratio. The Americans will be superior to us. And Kato and Balfour says to Kato, the British, Arthur Balfour says to Kato, he says, well, if the Americans can't build bases or improve on their bases in the Far East, then actually their fleet, when it gets to the Far East, won't have any bases. And so that'll actually give you rough equivalence with the American fleet should it drive all the way across the Pacific. So the Japanese then go to the American delegation. When the American admirals find out, they go, no, we need our bases in the Philippines and Guam, okay? We need to be able to build them up, all right? But Hughes silences them, just like the Japanese Navy minister silences his guys and says, no, we're going to agree to this because the Japanese are going to agree to the battleship holiday, they're going to agree to the ratios, they're going to agree to the scrapping, they're going to agree to all these things, and we're all going to end an arms race. So you're just going to have to accept this. So this is probably the most unpopular part of the treaty with the United States Navy, is the fact that west of the international dateline, the United States is not going to be able to build up any bases. Japan's also limited, by the way, by this. She's prevented from building bases in her Mandate Islands that she's been given by the Treaty of Versailles in the Marshalls and the Carolines. So Japan is also limited to a degree by this. Another one of the clauses in the treaty is the replacement. So this is called the replacement clause, and it basically shapes how you can replace ships you scrapped. Of course, you're not going to build any battleships, so you can't replace any of those. So what's actually part of this clause, I'll talk about in a second. And then the third part is the battle cruiser conversion. Okay. So the replacement clause is sometimes called the reconstruction clause, and what it does, it says, you know, you're going to have the battleships you're going to have. You can't modify them except. And these are added by the Navy delegations, and they say, well, we have to account for aircraft and submarines with torpedoes. So we should be able to modify our capital ships, that is our battle cruisers and our battleships, so that we can add anti-aircraft guns and so that we can add blisters on the sides as an anti-torpedo. But we're only limited to about 6,000 tons of modifications for that. And so that will open the door for modernization of some of these battleships that the powers retain, okay? So yeah, you can't build any new battleships, but there's a loophole in the treaty that'll let you modernize some of these ships. And of course, the priority here is battleships. One of the things that nobody realizes is that for anti-submarine warfare protection, you can actually change the propulsion systems, because if you're going to use fuel instead of coal, you can counter-flood fuel tanks as a protection measure against torpedoes and submarines. And the United States Navy will actually do this. She'll convert just about every one of her ships, and she'll modernize their propulsion systems for better defense against torpedoes, reputedly, okay? You see where I'm going here? That the treaty is actually causing people to think about things a little more carefully than they may already. The scrapping clause, yeah, we're gonna scrap these ships, does not prohibit testing on the scrapped ships. So we can take all of this stuff that we're gonna scrap and sink, either old ships that are already built or new ships that haven't been completed, and we can use airplanes against them. We can use torpedoes, guns, and we can test these ships so that we can improve our designs once we're allowed to build battleships again, or to help us modernize the existing ships. Another loophole in the treaty, and the United States will take a big advantage of this when it scraps some of its modern warships like the USS Washington. Conversion. This is part of what's called Article 9, and it basically allows each of the major contracting powers, that is the United Kingdom, the United States, and Japan, to convert two battle cruisers or battleships into aircraft carriers to kind of get up to speed with the British. The United States will take two of its most modern ships, the 40,000-ton Lexington and Saratoga, and it will convert both of those ships. So this is actually an exception to the treaty. These ships are far heavier than the allowed 27,000 tons, but because of the treaty, the United States gets to convert these two ships. So these two are on the scrap heap, but they get to be converted to aircraft carriers and not count. All right, so the United States realizes a windfall there. The Japanese take the battleship Kaga and convert her to an aircraft carrier, and the battlecruiser Akagi, and they convert her to an aircraft carrier. The British decide, you know what, we've got aircraft carriers. Why don't we watch what the Japanese and the Americans do? We'll just keep our old aircraft carriers that we have from World War II. And what we really want to do is complete the Hood, which is a battlecruiser. And so they get permission to complete the Hood, which will be the heaviest, largest ship in the world when it's completed at something like 44,000 or 45,000 tons, all right? And everybody knows what happens to the Hood, right? Okay, so choose wisely, Grasshopper. Wise choice. Wise choice, Grasshopper. Not so wise choice, okay? Other treaties and protocols, all right? So there's more than just the naval treaties, all right? There's something called the Four Power Pact. So one of the things the United States does prior to the conference is they contact the British and they go, listen, the Anglo-Japanese Naval Defensive Treaty of 1902 is coming up for renewal. It's going to expire in 1922. So it's a 20-year treaty, 1902 to 1922. You know what? We're just going to keep building as many ships as we can build unless you decide not to renew that treaty. As a sop to the Japanese and to the British, it's agreed that the Japan, the United States, Britain, and France will sign a treaty to replace the Anglo-Japanese Naval Treaty with something called the Four Power Treaty or the Four Power Pact. And roughly, the treaty says, hey, if any of us is attacked by anybody else, we'll all come to each other's aid, right? At sea. Well, who's gonna attack any of these guys? Who's got a navy to attack these guys? You know, Italy? Okay. But anyway, it's kind of an inside joke. Sorry about that. There's also this thing which is of interest to some people in our audience because it involves China. In fact, this is all about China. One of the things that Harding said is we've got, not only do we have a naval arms race, but we've got pressing problems in the Far East that need a solution. There's a failed state in China. We got to figure out how we're going to behave with respect to China and with the Chinese government. The Chinese government actually has representatives at the conference, even though China is a failed state, okay, at this time, kind of under a dictator. I don't know if Yuan Shikai is still the dictator or not, but China is not a unitary nation at this time. It's basically a geographic area over the historical landscape of what was the Qing dynasty, which was a barbarian dynasty of China until 1911. And then it breaks up and it becomes essentially a place where you've got like 11 to 15 warlords on any given day who are kind of running things. And that doesn't include the sort of the minor warlords that might be on the periphery, all right? So we gotta all agree what to do about China to guarantee China's sovereignty. And that's why Portugal, the Netherlands, and Belgium are part of the pact. And the agreement here is we're gonna guarantee Chinese sovereignty. And oh, by the way, the Japanese are not going to oppose the open door for American commerce to enter China. So part of this is a commercial treaty that formalizes the open door in the Far East. So not only does the United States have the open door in the Western Hemisphere, but she gets all of the other major powers to agree to the open door in the Far East, particularly Japan. And that was another sticking point with Japan, another reason the United States and Japan were so close to perhaps coming to blows in 1920-1921. Was this issue of China and the open door for the United States. The powers were aware that Japan felt she'd been cheated after the Great War because she'd made the 21 demands of China and then had been repudiated at Versailles by the powers, particularly as led by Woodrow Wilson, and forced to sort of back off on that. And so there were still some hard feelings and some concerns about Japan's excessive demands on China. However, it underwrote continued colonial extraterritoriality. So there's a clause in the Nine Power Treaty, and this is one of the treaties signed at Washington, along with the more famous Naval one, that basically said, if you're a European power and you have holdings in China, and it's the status quo, whatever you were doing before the war, before this treaty was signed, this treaty in no way limits your legitimate defense of your interests in China. So what does that mean to real politicians, geopoliticians? It means you can pretty much do whatever you want in China, okay? So it's kind of a toothless treaty, but it makes everybody feel good, right? Enforcement mechanism. Yep, there isn't one. The enforcement mechanism is trust. We're all gentlemen here. And we're all going to keep our word, right? That kind of an American thing, right? We all have to trust each other or the system won't work, all right? And initially, it works pretty good. They cut expenditures, the threat of war goes away, militarism is sort of backed off in Japan, all right? And everything in the 20s, it looks like this has been a huge success. And then, of course, the worldwide depression hits and it's not a great success. All right, so those are the basic things, and we can kind of get into maybe some of the details if I haven't already covered them in the questions. But let's talk about the U.S. Navy and the treaty system. So after this thing is signed, the organization in the Navy that has to execute all of the clauses of the treaty and sort of make sure that the Navy adheres to the treaty is this outfit called the General Board. So when I was studying the treaty, I go, well, the General Board, who are they? And so I learned about these guys, and by default, the guys who opposed the treaty the most become the agent for executing the treaty with respect to naval building. And so they really look at the loopholes. They actually adopt the entire 553 approach for all classes of ships. They go, you know what, when we go to Congress, we say, we're going to use the Washington Treaty as our benchmark for building cruisers, submarines, destroyers, and auxiliary ships, all right? And they actually turn this into a naval policy, and they say, one, we're second to no other navy. We're the second to none navy. We're as big as the British, all right? And they are okay with that, right? It also causes the British to adopt the one power standard. Now, the one power standard, and you find it in British cabinet documents of the period in the 20s and the 30s, they constantly talk about the one power standard, right? Which is, we're going to build our navy as big as the next biggest navy. Now, that previously to World War II had been a two power standard, so don't forget about that. Now it's a one power standard, and that power are people that speak the same language as you and sort of look like you, even though their accent is funny, called Americans, right? So So that's their budget enemy. They're going to build, but the real power that the one power standard is aimed at is by the British is Japan. Japan is the standard that they really are building to. So the threat of Germany isn't even on the horizon. So all of the 1920s in the British documents, the power that they're really concerned about is Japan. All right, not the United States. But the United States is a convenient benchmark to build to. So if the United States is building new cruisers, the British are going to build new cruisers, etc. Okay? And you're allowed to build cruisers and submarines and destroyers and floating dry docks and any other thing that floats as long as it's not more than 10,000 tons, according to the treaty. War Plan Orange. Because we're not allowed to have bases in the Far East, the United States is not allowed to have bases in the Far East, the United States has to change its war plan with Japan. Now, this is just a contingency plan, but the United States has been planning for war with Japan, the Navy has, since 1909, and the Joint Board has been planning for a war with Japan shortly after that. So there are these contingency plans, they're called the colored war plans. Orange is Japan. Black is Germany, red is Great Britain, green is Mexico. So what War Plan Orange does is the Navy has to figure out how are we going to get the fleet over to the Western Pacific, and the scenario here is the Japanese decide to go to war with us. What's the first thing they're going to attack? The Philippines. So we're going to go to the Philippines and rescue the Philippines. Well, with the status quo on fortifications, the United States can't build improved bases, they can't build naval air bases, they can't improve Guam. The United States, and Guam is not a big base. In fact, Guam's not a base at all. You know, Congress never voted any money to build it up. So when the treaty is signed, there's really nothing in Guam, you know, except snakes and tree snakes and totemona trees. So anyway, you know, the United States has to figure out how to get the fleet over there, and it learns, you know what, we're going to have to bring our bases with us. We're going to have mobile bases at sea. At sea logistics, at sea floating dry docks, at sea airfields, aircraft carriers. That's what we're going to have to do. So it forces the Navy to sort of think about naval warfare in more modern terms than it might otherwise have thought had it been allowed bases. And from joy and frustration to back, the United States Navy, the impact of the treaty actually is it causes the U.S. Navy to fall behind because the Navy might go to Congress and say, we need to build ships, we need to modernize ships, we need to finish the Lexington and the Saratoga. It takes 8 years to finish the Lexington and the Saratoga. That's how anemic money is for the Navy. And so what ends up happening is the United States falls behind in its building with respect to the British and particularly with respect to the Japanese. And maybe we can have another, you know, lecture, you know, at some point in the future, and I'll talk about the London Conference and Treaty, okay? Eventually the system breaks down. The first nation to sort of say, we're not going to play anymore, will be the Japanese. And it's not because of the London Treaty so much as it gets reprimanded by the League of Nations for invading Manchuria and turning it into a puppet state. But that causes the Japanese to go, oh, okay, you're going to criticize us for invading Manchuria. We're going to leave the naval treaty system and start building whatever the hell we want, okay? And so the arms race begins again circa 1933. The Japanese are in an arms race, but nobody else is racing them until the United States starts to respond with the Vincent Trammell Bill and the National Industrial Recovery Act. And we can maybe talk about some of those in the questions. The impact, incremental innovation is actually kind of mandated. The step-by-step orange strategy forces at-sea basing, mobile bases, more modern thinking about air power and sea power, different approach to power projection, a more combined arms approach rather than we're just going to send a bunch of battleships and have a big battleship battle. That's not to say the battleship is obsolete. It's still the paradigm, but they're not allowed to build any. They have to sort of play with what they've got, right? No new toys. And so that sort of leads to sort of a freezing of things, which actually turns out to be good. Submarines, this is what happens with the submarine classes. Unrestricted submarine warfare is outlawed in the interwar period, but submarines aren't restricted at all by the treaties. And the United States Navy actually does a pretty good job, but it has to build long-range submarines. So the treaty forces the Navy to say, well, we've got to build long-range submarines. And that's what gives us our wonderful Tambor and Gato-class submarines at the beginning of the war. Not designed for unrestricted submarine warfare, designed to cruise long distances and carry lots of torpedoes, okay, to sink ships, sink warships. Anemic carrier destruction for the U.S. Navy until Franklin Roosevelt comes into office. They try to use aircraft tenders as sort of floating bases. They want ubiquitous air, but they have problems with the Army here. And then there's London Treaty loopholes that allow them to build some interesting ships. There's one of the interesting ships that's a treaty. This is a flying deck cruiser. But notice it's got an angled flight deck. The United States Navy almost built this ship in the 1930s as a direct result of the Washington and London naval treaties. And if the United States had built this and tested it in its fleet games and its war game at the Naval War College, they probably would have realized, oh man, this is a really great design. You can land and take off aircraft at the same time on this thing. And that would have made a huge difference, at least at the beginning of World War II, until everybody else built angled deck carriers. But it was never built. Didn't get built until the Korean War. There's the war plan orange. The initial plan is one big thrust to rescue the Philippines and bail Doug MacArthur and Eisenhower out if the Japanese attack. And then, we can't fortify Guam, we can't fortify Manila, we can't fortify Subic Bay, so I guess we're just going to have to go step by step through here and seize bases. Of course, the Marines love this because it means they have a mission, right? We can seize bases, right? And that's why the Marine Corps can have an identity and have a mission and have a life, okay? Docking facilities, I won't go into this. We build, one of the most important things that we build, that we design in the interwar period, will be floating dry docks to support the fleet overseas. And that's one of the floating dry docks. That's off of Espiritu Santo, which is in the South Pacific. And that is the West Virginia. That is the West Virginia. And I thought this would be a good place to stop. I have one more thing to say about the Washington Treaty, is it sort of froze the lessons learned from World War I. So what we see happen in war sometime is that we learn these lessons, and we go, boy, everybody knows what the lessons of this war are, right? You know, you got to pay attention to this. You know, you got to do this, you know. And then we just sort of slowly drift back to doing business the way we did for before, and those lessons don't seem to be is important, and we sort of unlearn the lessons learned. And the Washington Treaty kind of froze those in place by saying, you know what, battleships aren't so important, so you don't get to build any of them. We will let you build submarines and aircraft carriers and cruisers and dirigibles and land-based air and all this other stuff and radios and radars. And so it sort of freezes in place some things that perhaps might not have been frozen in place had it just been open season for building navies the way sailors wanted to build navies after World War I. And with that said, I'm ready for questions. Thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, if you have a question for Dr. Kuehn, we will invite you to step down to either of the two microphones we have positioned at the end of the staircases.
Is this on?
Yep.
Yeah. Yeah, my question is this. How much of our idea of Japan in the 1920s and the 1930s was due to American arrogance?
What was that last part again, sir? It was due to American
how much? What? How much of the naval, the treaties, the weight limitations, and all this and that was due mainly from American arrogance.
American arrogance?
Arrogance.
Is that what you're saying? Okay,
yes.
So the question is, how much of this treaty is due to American arrogance? Okay. Well, the implication here is that the Japanese are victims and the Americans are these arrogant victimizers. And I don't see it that way. There is a certain amount of cultural American arrogance, but the Americans actually feel like they're solving real problems. And the American policy here is we just want to be able to, you know, allow China to develop and be a real nation. You know, we kind of want Japan to do what she's going to do, but we don't want Japan to be imperialistic and chauvinistic, and still have to protect the Philippines. They still belong to us. You know, one of the solutions that the State Department comes up with in the interwar period is, let's just give the Philippines their independence, and then we don't have to worry about rescuing the Philippines, right? But the open door as an economic and diplomatic policy has the level of an icon or a shrine in the American mind of this period. Remember, too, the Americans are isolationist. It's not the idea that we're going to go out and put a big footprint down out there and solve the world's problems. We're going to show the world how to solve its problems with our good behavior, with our magnanimity, with our willingness to scrap these horrible, evil warships, okay? So there's some arrogance in thinking about it that way. The fascinating thing is, you know, nobody ever criticizes the Japanese for being arrogant in China and telling China, well, you basically need to become a province of Japan. Nobody criticizes the British for their arrogance in wanting to maintain their imperial global colonial empire, you know. The United States, compared to all these other folks, you know, is trying to get rid of its colonies, all right, whereas the others are actually trying to add their colonies. So, you know, I take a broader view of this. But I agree in some sense there is an American arrogance. I take a very provocative view of the Washington Treaty. If you go back to Samuel Eliot Morison's book, The Rising Sun in the Pacific, which is the first book in his official history of the U.S. Navy in World War II, he treats the Washington Naval Treaty like it was the worst thing to ever happen to the United States Navy. And that's the reason we lost World War II. Well, we didn't lose it, did we? Okay? And so I've always wondered, you know, why is this treaty so bad? I'm saying I'm provocative because I think the treaty was a good thing. I think the treaty on balance saved money. I think the treaty on balance prevented war. I think the treaty on balance led to stability, not just in Europe, but in the globe. All right? And so if that's arrogance, guilty as charged. Well, I think somebody else does. Yes, sir.
Hey, John, thanks for your presentation tonight. The list of participants on the U.S. side that you had up showed some pretty heavy hitters politically, and yet the Navy decides that their technical representative is going to be a promotable captain. Why was the chief of naval operations or the deputy chief not the principal naval representative for the United States at the conference?
That is a really good question. So the backstory here is personalities, okay? So the Secretary of the Navy up until a couple months before the conference is a guy named Josephus Daniels, but then Harding gets elected and Daniels, who is Wilson's Secretary of the Navy, is out of a job, right? He's out of a job. So, and so the Harding administration has just come in. They've only taken office on March 4th, because remember, that was back when presidents were inaugurated on March 4th, right? A really cool day. Daniels was at odds with some in the Navy, but he generally supported the CNO Benson. But he was the previous administration, so his guys were sort of like not popular with the new administration. It's like, say, Joe Biden took office and there was a general from Trump's administration that did things that Biden didn't like, and so now he's sort of in the negative column. So we're not going to put him in charge of the delegation to China for the Washington Naval Treaty of 2021. We're going to put somebody else in charge of that delegation. So that's part of it. The other piece here is Sims. So Admiral Sims, who'd been the commander of the naval forces in Europe in World War I, had been at total odds with the Democratic administration and Josephus Daniels. He and Daniels were very acrimonious after the war ended, and Pratt is part of William Sims' band of brothers. He's a William Sims protege. And so when the new administration comes in, they go, well, we're going to show you what's what. You know, we're going to pick one of William Sims' guys, not somebody from the favored group that surrounds the CNO, who I think at this time is, I want to say it's not Benson anymore. I think it's Eberle or something like that. I'm trying to remember his name. But so we're not going to pick that guy. And they go, well, why don't you pick somebody from the general board? And they go, oh, well, Pratt's on his way to the general board. You ordered him to the general board. So he'll also represent the general board, even though he hasn't formally joined the general board yet. So that's why they picked Bill Pratt. And Bill Pratt's the perfect guy. I mean, he is one of my favorite guys from the interwar period because he's a guy who's willing to buck the system. He's a guy who's willing to say, well, this isn't right. He's a guy who's willing to say, well, Navy, you're wrong on this. Just like his mentor, William Sims, was willing to say, well, we're wrong about this. You're wrong about this, Big Navy. We need to do this. Or you're wrong about this, Mr. Secretary Daniels. We're going to do this. So it's a very complicated sort of personal situation, all right? And it's sort of a slap in the face at the old administration as well to kind of pick Bill Pratt, who's this young, fiery reformer. Of course, Pratt's career is ruined, right? No. He goes on to be the head of the Naval War College. He's a regular member of the General Board, very prolific, writing in proceedings about air policy, modernization of battleships. He becomes Commander-in-Chief of the United States Fleet. Sink us. He becomes Commander-in-Chief of the United States Fleet, and then he becomes Chief of Naval Operations. All right. So Pratt comes out of this he earns a lot of people's respect by his advocacy of the treaty. All right, he actually convinces members of the General Board to maybe give this treaty a chance, all right, even though initially they hate it. I mean, one of the guys in the Navy, a guy named Dudley Knox, who's also a Sims protege, wrote a book after the treaty was over saying The Eclipse of American Naval Power, and it was all about the Washington Treaty. And it's sort of the thing that Samuel Eliot Morrison read and sort of formed his attitude that this thing was the worst thing that had ever happened to the United States, and that's why we lost World War II. Okay. Sir.
Thank you, sir, for your presentation. Quickly, I'm from Wilmington, North Carolina. The USS North Carolina is docked there and permanently now. So could you briefly comment on how the Washington Naval Treaty affected the construction of that class of
warship? That's a good case study. Okay, so the treaty freezes battleship construction for 15 years, all right? For 15 years. That gets extended at the London Conference, all right? For another 6 years, I think, all right? And so the North Carolinas are on the design board, but they can't be built until the holiday is over. When Japan leaves the treaty in 1936, We finally get to start laying the keel for the new battleships, the Alabamas and the North Carolinas, and then eventually the New Jersey class, all right? Well, the North Carolinas, though, are supposed to be built with 14-inch guns, and so the design for the North Carolina is different than the New Jerseys, it's different from the Alabama, because those ships were designed to be built with 14-inch guns because of the London Treaty. But in the Washington Treaty, and then in the later London Treaty, there's something called the Escalator Clause. And that clause says, if a contracting power builds a ship, leaves the treaty, and then builds ships with bigger guns, we can build our ships with the bigger guns. And so when the North Carolinas are just getting ready to make the design decision for the guns in 1937, the intel comes in that the Japanese are building 16-inch gun ships again. Of course, the intel's wrong. The Japanese are building 18-inch gunships, all right? And so that's how the North Carolinas get their 16-inch guns. And the North Carolinas are a good class. One of them does a superb job at the night battle of Guadalcanal in 1942, really saves the day. Radar-equipped battleship under Willis Lee kind of saves the day. Okay, it's not the North Carolina, though. I'm trying to remember which one it was, South Dakota or one of those. Okay, yeah. Yep. I'll repeat your question.
Okay. I know it's dangerous to speculate with counterfactuals, but I'm curious
Well, I think Wilson surviving, which is unlikely. I mean, Wilson not having a stroke and Edith Wilson becoming president of the country. But let's assume he gets elected to another term, right? Or the Democrats win in 1920. I'm trying to remember who ran. Was it the guy from New York that ran that year? But anyway, I think we're still going to have the same problems unresolved because Wilson had sort of put his finger in the dike at Versailles, right? When he decided, okay, if everybody joins the League of Nations, I won't finish completion of the 1916 Naval Act, which is going to build 48 battleships and whatever else I want to build, right? Because we don't want anybody to tell us what to do at sea anymore, neither the Germans nor the British, right? They're going to respect the right of a neutral power. This goes back to your arrogant question here, right? But the problem with Japan is not solved, right? The Versailles Treaty has still not solved the problem of Japan. And Japan's program is an 8-8 fleet. They're committed to that. 8 battleships and 8 battlecruisers. That's what they need to defend against the United States. The United States counter to that is, oh, you build your 8-8 fleet, we'll build our 48-8 fleet, okay? You know, 48 battleships and 8 battlecruisers. So now I'm exaggerating there. I think it was only 4 battlecruisers, but still, that's a lot of battlecruisers. So that might have changed things, but I think there would still have been a need for another conference. It may not have been in Washington, though. It may have been in Geneva, all right? And in fact, the treaty regime is actually, on the international stage, I said there's no mechanism for enforcement. There isn't, but there are ongoing naval talks at Geneva. And so there's all these committee meetings, and the United States, which doesn't join the League of Nations, always sends representatives, including guys from Section 2 of the General Board, to these meetings and plenipotentiary meetings and pre-meetings. And there's actually a naval conference in Geneva, the Geneva Naval Conference, where the British don't agree to the United States proposal for cruisers. And so the United States finally actually passes a naval bill to build cruisers, okay? So it's a complicated thing, but I think we're still going to have some sort of, you still had the problem with China. You still had the problem of the Japanese Anglo Naval Pact. Those were all things that still needed to be fixed. Whether we would have gotten a treaty that is this limiting, I'm not so sure, okay? Because we don't have Charles Evans Hughes. He's the genius here. He's the institutional diplomatic genius who kind of realizes, here's how I can accomplish what President Harding wants me to accomplish, but force the Japanese and the British into an agreement. I'm going to make them an offer they can't refuse, right? And he does, okay?
Ladies and gentlemen, if you could join me one more time in thanking Dr. John Kuehn.
Thanks, everybody. Thanks.